Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to tonight's talk by Daniel Lobia. I am Peter Jameson, and I am the chairman of the Friends of Czech Heritage. Daniel bears the illustrious name of Lobia. He was born in Bristol into this extended family. He is the grandson of the last Jewish owner of the factory that became Schindler's Ark. But unlike so many others, they have returned, in their case, to the city of Brno, from whence they fled, now in the spirit of reconciliation. A partnership has been formed with the city. This and the foundation of a new cultural centre around what was the Lobia factory and became Schindler's Ark are the dawn of a new era. Daniel, over to you.
So thank you hugely for the introduction, and I'm just looking through the participants. It's also great to hear to see some of the members of the family there. So it's really their stories that I'm presenting today. And first of all, just a note for the Friends of the Czech Heritage, and really thank them for the work. First of all, in keeping us linked to a faraway country of which we know nothing, and that really is a phrase that clearly has haunted our generation. From what I wrote in their newsletter, for me was something of the first Brexit in 1938, when a line was agreed between the British and the Germans and the French, which split Czechoslovakia and split Europe. And it went right through the stream in our factory. So as you'll hear later, my grandfather woke up one morning and there were Nazis on the other side of the bridge in his factory. The second work they do, which I think is very important, is actually on the sites of heritage themselves. And a lot of what I'm trying to do is bring back some of the people in our family, and some of the stories back into those places so they can begin to speak. And so they can speak of what happened, of Czech history, and then what happened next. So none of our families survive in Czechoslovakia. After that moment when it was split, they're scattered throughout the world. It's wonderful to see that actually some of them today, Chris Boswell, I can see Kat Boswell in and Chris in Australia, Brazil, Canada, throughout the world, but none really survived in Czechoslovakia. But I think within that spirit of the Friends of the Czech Heritage, it's a place that still lives with us. And you'll see a little bit those connections in the book over the last century. Maybe you could just unmute. I would like to hear how many people are from, how many Lobias there are. Maybe you could just unmute for a second and shout something as I put on the PowerPoint. I know you're not meant to unmute, but the Lobias don't always obey the rules. So maybe you could just say something, members from the family.
Hi, Daniel, Caroline.
My mother was...
Hi, Daniel, from Australia, the Boswells.
Fantastic.
Hi, Daniel. Ivan from the UK.
Good morning, Daniel. Chris from Australia.
Jackie from Brazil.
So fantastic to hear.
Sadie here from the US. Yeah, in my grandmother's tradition, we always speak up.
Good. So that's wonderful. It's wonderful that the Friends of the Czech Heritage has kind of brought together not just the places, but also some of the people here. You'll see within families, they're full of stories, and any family. So not just the Lobia family, but I want to go back on a trip which clearly follows our family, but also goes back to the real heart of Europe, which I think the Friends of Czech Heritage keep us connected to. And for me, the heart of Europe is in Czechoslovakia, and it's in Moravia, and in some special places, Brno, Brunionets, which were for a very long period associated with our family and which we hope to stay connected with. And I'm going to tell you some of the stories of the family, which just I've really been lucky to travel around the world and collect them. And they really are for the Lobias who are, obviously for my parents, Anne and Tom, but for the Lobias also who are scattered throughout the world. And you'll see them in this book, which hopefully you can see. It's called The Arks, and it's the Lobia stories. It's putting some of these stories back into two places, many people don't know that if you are on Schindler's list, the place you were taken, his ark, he went home to Moravia, and it was this factory that you see at the top. And the other places I want to mention is the other branch of the family. There's two branches. One, the symbol is the factory, and the other one is the Villa Tugendhat, which for me is a symbol of this great historical movement from leaving the ghetto to the center of European modernism of this Jewish family. So first of all, the arcs. I mean, I liked it just because of a poet. I like the name, the sound of the arcs, but it obviously does have a couple of meanings to it. First of all, it relates to the book by Keneally, Schindler's Ark, which relates to the story of the ark, Noah's Ark, where Jews are saved. So if you see that factory above, that's where 1,200 Jews were saved. The second bit I also try and bring out is art in the Jewish tradition is also, we carry around our book, our stories in the ark as we travel around the world. And I really do think families have these stories within them. And it's very central to the identity that you can give a shape to your family story. It's not easy to do. It's been through a lot in the last 100 years. But I think inside you are some places, some maps, faraway places, but also this story, which I want to share with you today. Now, there's a third meaning when I tried to translate it into Czech, and which came out was, and it shows something under communism, but under communism, arcs was also the folders they would keep on people. So people who were citizens would have a folder with papers inside, which was all the Secret Service material that was collected on you. So actually when we translated it into Czech, we had to change that name slightly, and it became the Arts of Life. And you'll see on the front cover those three images. The first one is the factory, which leaving the ghetto in 1848, very quickly, they set up a factory in 1854. It became one of the most innovative, largest wool textile factories in Europe. Brno was really a center of innovation. It had the largest textile school in the Austro-Hungarian Empire. And even in 1919, it was producing 60-80% of the textiles for the whole of the Austro-Hungarian Empire. And then in 1938, as you will hear, the factory was stolen by the Nazis and stolen by Oskar Schindler, as he was a Nazi. But it was here that he saved 1,200 Jews. So if you are on Schindler's list in Krakow, you would be taken here. And it was very important that he came home. He came home to Moravia. This is where he came from. To save his 1,200 Jews. And yet many Czechs don't fully accept this side to him, and they don't fully know about that factory, probably his most important, one of the most important monuments of the Second World War. And it continued as a factory, these places, and it's interesting with Czech heritage, they tell the stories of the century. It continued under communism as a factory, producing textiles in high volume. It survived the Velvet Revolution in 1989. We're working very closely with the local manager of the factory because he had my grandfather's ability, Walter, he had an ability to touch a fabric, to touch wool. And a little bit like wine, he would know exactly where it came from and exactly how to reproduce it. It was one of the few factories that went all the way from raw wool to the end product, and it was able to control that full process. So after 1989, they were working one day a week. And then he went to Denmark as part of the European community. He touched some of the fabrics they used there for furniture and came back to this factory and was able to reproduce them. And within 2 months, they were producing factory fabrics which were of better quality and half the price of the producers in Denmark, and he went back and they were soon working 7 days a week. And they said, yes, we will buy your fabrics, but we're not going to allow you to touch our textiles again. So really, this is the site which we're now connected to again. And I'll show you at the end a little piece of the next stage. And it's a factory for me that really does tell the story of the 20th century right up to the present day. And then the second building is the Tugendhat villa. There's two branches to our family, stemming from Aaron and Jacob for the factory and for Moses to the Tugendhat villa. And you can see for me, it is one of the high points of a very special culture you saw in Central Europe, a Jewish, German, radically modern culture. And this is the second story I tell in my book. The top one is around escapes during the Second World War. And the first one is of an early escape from the ghettos in 1848 to really the center of European culture. The Jews melted into modern culture in the 1930s, produced some incredible houses and contributed very closely to both Czechoslovakia, and I think felt very at home, particularly in Czechoslovakia and in Moravia. And they're two sides of the same coin, of a culture which has a light side, created some of the high points of European culture, and clearly a dark side of the concentration camps. And that's really the story I tell within this book. And then, of course, the third one, we actually tried to use the image of the girl in red, but in the end, it is suitcases. And they say of the Jews that they are the people of books and of suitcases. So it's really these stories of survival and the people I talk to who survived, including my grandfather, my father, Eliska, and others, which explain the survival of our family and the survival of the Jews. So I also have, I maybe need to explain, I'm also accused by Thomas Keneally in the introduction of being a Moravian patriot. And I think, as in most accusations, I have to try and live up to that. And there are two or three ways in which I think the focus of this book is on Brno and Brunionets, maybe not on Prague so much. It's on Moravia. And there's two or three reasons. The first one is Thomas Keneally says that I do point out that Judaism in Moravia was actually quite different than in Prague. It wasn't concentrated in a ghetto. It was very distributed in the smaller towns and villages. And because the Jews had to escape some of the more difficult laws, which preventing them from marrying, only one of their children was allowed to marry, and discrimination. And in Moravia, they distributed them in the smaller villages. So they were very much more mixed in the population. And it was also quite important for Oskar Schindler. He grew up in one of these small towns, but next to him, he played with a Jewish family. He had friends who were Jewish. And there was this mixing of German, of Jewish, of Czech, of European culture, which was particularly strong in Moravia. And there's two other points. I do see Moravia, when I'm looking at it, as really the heart of Europe. And it is a place which is this crossroads in the center of Europe. It links the East and the West. It's where the Bible was translated into the Slovak languages, was in Moravia. And it also links the North and the South through the Moravian Gate, which is a very, very ancient connection between the northern lands and the southern lands. In fact, has some of the oldest human populations. And has always been innovative from some of the first textiles, some of the first string revolution, and then more recently, the genetic strings. So some of those innovations where genetics was also discovered within Brno. So for me, that's really where we're taking you back. And I will try and live up a little bit to avoid you do today in the Lobia family, but also into the heart of Europe. But it's also a very simple story, and whatever the name, really the theme of the book is follow your name. Hopefully most of you have it, and talk to your children and your grandchildren about your name. Follow it, where you came from, and it helps you to an extent find out who you and your family are. And many of these stories, they will disappear unless you talk to the next generation about them. So actually, it's quite fitting. I start with in the book with what's in a name, and these were words written by my mother, Anne Smith, So it starts with Anne Smith. You can see my father, Thomas, named after Thomas Masaryk. You can see the presence. She always said this Czech, slightly emotional, lively, impatient presence in Middle England. But on one day in 1965, she marries Thomas Lobier and changes quite remarkably in one day from Anne Smith to Anne Lobier. And she started writing, you know, she wrote me two or three pages on what's in a name. And my mother was a historian. We were lucky. She actually helped write the history curriculum of the United Kingdom. And she always reminded me that even the United Kingdom is four countries. It's got four histories. And that's what you need to put together. And she had been back actually to help Central Europe write their history curriculums after the fall of communism in 1989. And she could tell me the stories of the textbooks. At the beginning, you had to take the communist textbooks and tip X out pages to write this new history, to see how it changed. So she was the one really who started it with this idea of what's in a name. And I'm just going to read a very small piece from about my mother. So my mother was a historian and fascinated by words. She listened to names as other people noticed clothes. As she slept, the historian in her dreamt of where the name Lobier had come from, the stories, histories in these two words she'd been given with a ring. People did respond to her differently. At parties, job interviews, in post offices, as she signed her name, my mother noticed quite frequently, when I give or sign my name, people comment, an unusual name, where does it come from? I am British with a Scottish father and my mother from Yorkshire where I grew up. How do I explain where my name, Anne Lobier, comes from? What's in a name? Anne talked to me about how to write the history of a name, and she started writing the family history. I argued with her about whether real stories or history were at the center of family history. I felt a family tree without the leaves of stories was too bare. So I started collecting these stories like autumn leaves full of color as they fall away. Of how the family escaped from Czechoslovakia during the war, of life in the 1930s, of leaving the ghetto back in time to find my origins. So that's really the first bit is follow your name to find out how you and your family are. And it does always open into real history. The second chapter is the silence that's in families. And what is it that breaks that silence that allows these stories to come out? I talked to many, many women in the 80s and 90s, often telling some of the stories of escape for the first time. And it wasn't always psychological. It wasn't always psychological why they didn't speak. It was because they were living, and they were living forward, and they were surviving, and they were having children, and they were having grandchildren. This is my wedding in 97 with my uncle Gary, who really broke the silence for me, and my father to the right. And to some extent, I wasn't interested in it so much then. I was getting married. I was living. Why look backwards when you're going forwards? That was the real revenge, I think, of many of that generation. But they looked permanent to me in 1997, these strong characters from another world, from a lost world in Central Europe before the war. But very quickly, those stories do disappear. And it was really only the year afterwards that I went back with my uncle, Gary, there on the left, for the first time to Brno. And he had never been back from 1938 to 1998. And he went back to try and find his papers, to try and find a little piece of him had left behind, which actually I'm working with Ravi on still today, his son. So this is a little bit from that breaking of the silence, which occurred that one remarkable day when I accompanied him back to Brno. The Lobiers were always late. And if you'll notice in the book, I actually have to put one of the troubles of writing a family history, you have to put a footnote, because someone did point out to me that Fritz Lobier was not late always. And that for me was certainly the exception that proved the rule. The Lobiers were always late. Ever since they left Czechoslovakia in 1938, the present had run ahead of them. You meet them in a pub and they would arrive 10, 20, 30 minutes late. You realize there is Greenwich Mean Time and there is Lobia Mean Time. The family are no longer quite synchronized with their watches or with history unfolding around them. It is 60 years later, 1998, Gary Lobia, my uncle, leaves his home late and arrives at Heathrow Airport late. He has a strong emotional and even physical presence, which can often make up for his lateness, the flash of his eyes and his eyebrows, the wave of his hands like a clock moving too quickly. In a flow of Eastern European charm and persistence, he passes through check-in and passports, leaving the officials in his wake. The X-ray machine scans his shoes, his wallet, even his belt, sees into and through him. He looks untidy, even with no clothes on, even on X-ray. Yet he has nothing to declare but his memories of a faraway country of which those around him, the check-in attendant, the passport policeman, even his children, now know very little. His memories flash up momentarily on the X-ray monitor, all haze and noise, a faded map, Brno, his town of birth, in black and white as he passes through. These are the memories not yet shared in our family, the silences beneath the surface and only visible maybe on X-ray. As he gets to the gate, the flight attendant looks at his face, its folds of character and history, down at his passport and back up into his sky blue eyes to confirm the resemblance. Is it him? They're not quite sure, that his identity is quite captured by the passport and he is late. No, Beer, that is a distinctive name, they ask. Yes, he replies, fixing the officials with his deep, powerful eyes, dreamy, which can carve out the present when he wants them to. The name meant lion and bear in Czechoslovakia, he explains, arching his eyebrows into exclamation marks, challenging and charming them. And that is only with his eyebrows. But it was badly translated into English. Something of the meaning was lost. It is now low and beer, he adds, with a flow of his hands, almost waving the officials to let him by, like a wind, the red sign blinking above him, gate closed. They smile for a moment, despite their official uniforms. They're drawn into his world, his past, for a split second. At the back of their minds, they smile at how meaning can change, lion bear to low beer. And they smile at how meaning and name can be further broken down, low alcohol beer, high whiskey, high spirits. Yet the clock is ticking, the gate is closing, there is no time to smile, they cannot be late. Hurriedly, they hand him back his passport and let him pass, the last person onto the plane. Like that scene, I remember the rush of everyday life meant we didn't ask the questions of my family history from those who knew. So I then do go back to him, back with him, and he arrives in Brno quite distinctively. Gary and I both converge on Brno, Gary from Prague, myself from Vienna, we tracing paths on a map like migrant birds. I arrive first on time and wait at the Brno train station. I sit patiently beneath the huge white moon railway clock and I wait. Gary likes to say the surest way to be on time for a train is to miss the one before, and so it proves. But it was certainly worth the wait. And when he arrived in the station, I remember him leaving the station and he had this map inside him. He refused to look at a map of Brno nowadays. So we followed this map from about 1938 in 1998. And he took me around the town and we got terribly lost. And he refused to ask directions. But he did find his senses and a little bit of himself. And he took me to the places, his house. And I would just talk about probably the moment which opened up to me was when he took me to the Tugendhat home on that day. And he started to talk about the family history. So Gary has found his directions by now, and he leads me to the glass house, the Tugendhat home, commissioned by Greta Tugendhat, born Lobia. This is perhaps the most famous building in the town, built by Mies van der Rohe, a free-flowing building, the weight taken from the walls with chrome pillars, its bones, and glass, its skin. This allowed the occupants to reshape the internal spaces, redraw their geography without constraints and to their liking. Gary had played there as a child with his sister, played hide and seek in the free-flowing spaces. He remembers it was kept too modern, too tidy, he felt, for children. Gary leads me through the entrance, modest and hidden like that of a snail, and down the spiral staircase into the glass room. At the bottom of the stairs, space and light open out into a new world that Gary had played in. We looked out to the skyline of Brno as the shadows begin to grow in the afternoon. The 5 minute wide, 5 meter wide and 3 meter high planes of glass are translucent, melting any distinction between inner and outer space. At the touch of a button in the 1920s, the glass windows would descend into the floor beneath, 60 years ahead of its time. The domestic brown air would mix, the surrounding geography breathe inward, and your vision self could breathe outwards. It seemed to melt Kant's idea that geography was an outer sense. It could shape the most intimate inner maps of our identity. Gary takes in a deep breath and then breathes out, in and out, breathing in and out several decades of family history. He breathes in the architecture, not as a house or a museum, but as a home. He sees children playing, the spaces of the living room flowing like a river with family. He hears Greta Tugendhat explaining, you have to move through this space. Its rhythm is like music. So he starts to move and listen to the music of the place. Gary explains to me that it is a beautiful house, but you can really only understand its architecture, the new way of living the family yearns for when it is a home filled with the real stories and people who live there. He remembers feeling at home in Moravia, where the Lobia family could express themselves openly and without limits in business, architecture, and culturally. Gary saw Moravia as the heart of Europe, a cruciform linking north and south, east and west. Gary had glimpsed a promised land for the Jews in the heart of Europe, where, like Moses, he could never settle. Gary is drawn to the glass windows like a butterfly to light. The glass is not transparent, as modernism had promised. It is full of reflections of the outside, of his inside, and of the history of the 20th century. We look out over the town, uncle and nephew, generations side by side in the present, and for a moment in the past too. Gary feels at home, and at the same time can feel a certain distance to the town, to the past. After all these years, he has found a point of perspective on the events that had passed in between. He sits down with me on the chairs in front of the glass wall and tells me about some of the shadows he still sees, how the Gestapo had used these Lobia buildings during the war, the family members who had remained and whose ashes were still blowing in the wind. Gary seems to open up like the glass room we are sitting in, his inside and outside mixing. He tells me for the first time his stories and his feelings of faraway places. It was the moment the story of my name opened up. The walls came down, the light came in, the silence shimmered away, and I was drawn into the journey of my name. So that was the day where the silence kind of opened, and we went through the town, lost time, sometimes finding ourselves in 38, sometimes in 1998. And he did find some of the papers of himself as a child. And that's really how that day ends. And I think you can see bringing the stories back into a place. I think it's important for heritage. I talk a lot with the friends about that. But I think he also found a part of himself back there, which it had not been seen for 60 years.
And we've established a Lobia trail of 10 key places in Brno, which really in those places of heritage tries to put back the people and the stories and also what happened next. You can put your phone and you get the OR link, which these stories will speak to you from these places of heritage.
So then when those stories open up, you really have to capture them before they disappear. And it's quite a brief period where I guess it's also my interest, but also the people are there to tell the stories and tell the stories of why I'm there. Why am I in born in Bristol, grew up in Birmingham with this Czech father and this slightly ridiculous name, Lobia, at least ridiculous in English. So the story is, this is the story of my grandfather, and that's a picture of my grandfather in the Czech Republic and of my father. And I capture these arts of escape. So I really want to talk to you now about the first part of the book, which are the arts of escape. and they really start in 1938 when Czechoslovakia is split into two. Gary tries to leave and join the army to fight. There was a great foray of the Czechs to fight the Germans, and there's some evidence they would have had a good chance. He was only 14, so he was refused entry into the Czech army. But this is my my grandfather, and if you remember that bridge on the front of the book, that bridge from one day to the next became this this international frontier. So he woke up the next day, and this was the vision of Czechoslovakia. So this takes you back now to 1938. My grandfather, Walter Lobia, was standing on a line which has just cut Czechoslovakia into Europe into, and the Jewish world into pieces. The line recently drawn in at the Munich Agreement in September 1938, cut across the Czechoslovakian countryside, hugging its wooded hills, rivers, and villages. The line followed the stream which flowed through the Lobia factory, which would become Schindler's Ark, past its woolen mills and past the small railway that joined the warehouses. The stream had brought power to the factory. Now it brought politics and war. Here in September 1938 was my short, athletic, strongly built Jewish grandfather, armed with his walking stick, facing the oncoming battalion of Nazi soldiers. Walter now stood face to face with the German soldiers on the other side of the stream. This small provincial stream had, within the last few days, become an international frontier. The water was running just the same through the factory, but now this thin silver stream was all that kept him alive. Walter pointed out the stream with his stick to the Nazis. The sky above was cloudy with a heavy autumnal light. It looked like it might break any moment into a shower or storm. The soldiers wrapped their large flapping military coats around themselves, stepped to the edge of the stream and looked across at him with disbelief. Walter mustered his best German, holding back his anger, his humiliation, his fear, like the clouds held back the rain above. Gentlemen, this is as far as you go. This stream is the border. Your leader Hitler agreed in the Munich Agreement. I am in Czechoslovakia. You may now be in Germany, but you can go no further according to international law. My grandfather was the technical director of the factory. He could tell where wool came just by touching it. He was more technical than political, bringing innovations to treating wool, fixing colors and electricity to cooling the machines. Deep inside him, he was a Jewish man, but he would learn a new language each year by reading the literature with a dictionary, French, English, Czech, Spanish, Italian. He spoke Latin with some friends. He had taken to heart what the first president of Czechoslovakia, Thomas Masaryk, had said to his peoples. As many languages you know, as many times you are a human being. Apparently the Germans got down from their armed vehicles on their side of the stream and fanned out along its banks. They smiled at each other, leaning on their guns like walking sticks with a dark humor and menace. My lieber Herr, we hear you, but we cannot see your paper. Is this stream really a frontier? There are no border posts. The line you mentioned is not marked anywhere, but then what frontiers are anymore? Why don't you come over to this side of the stream so we could discuss and see what to do? Walter wanted to discuss, to win at least the argument, but he hesitated and he stood his ground. If Walter had crossed the split of the stream, discussed, negotiated as Chamberlain had done, the soldiers would have packed him into their truck and off to a concentration camp. He may have appeased the argument, but he would have lost the battle. Walter stood his ground, protected by his stream. He felt a cold shiver pass down his spine, reaching to his feet and freezing him to the ground with a mixture of fear and stubbornness. I often wonder what my grandfather was defending that day on that frontier and from where he drew the force to stand his ground, like the lion and bear in his name. He was a Czech nationalist and fluent in Czech. He was Jewish. He spoke and admired German, was one of them. He studied in Bradford in England. He sent his children to Czech, German and English schools. He loved Janáček and Mozart. He had seen how the Czechoslovakia had gotten the best from its peoples to become one of the most creative and 10 most prosperous countries in the world. I think he was defending a European identity in the heart of Central Europe. He refused to be split into pieces, a Jewish, a Czech, a German part. Walter stood at the crossing with his stick, a Jew manning the borders of a broken Czechoslovakia. He told the soldiers to phone Prague or Berlin to check their borders and orders, which apparently they did. This was how Walter Lobbia held up the Nazis' invasion of this part of Czechoslovakia for three full days. So those are the stories that you start to find in the family, and explain a little bit why you are where you are, and a little bit those stories behind the people. And then this is that factory. This is just one of the buildings. To the right of here is the Schindler's Ark, where 1,200 Jews were saved during the war. He chose this factory partly because he was coming home, and that's one of the things Thomas Canini says I show in the book is this Czech, this Moravian side to the story. And he also chose it because they could live and work in one building, so they wouldn't get shot at by the German guards who are in here. And then to the left is a huge and very beautiful textile workshop. And apparently these buildings, when they did show a few scenes here, they hardly needed to be changed because they're very much in the state that they were during the 1940s. And part of the book does bring that story of Schindler back into the Czech Republic. It's often seen by people as a Polish story, and yet the key events occurred here. And this is a little bit about the enigma of Schindler, and it's one of the stories I really do want to bring back into the Czech Republic. Who is Schindler, and why did he do what he did? They say that for every three Jews, there are four opinions. And on Oskar Schindler, there are even more. Was he just a Nazi and profiteer? Did he just save himself? Did he just enjoy the challenge, see fighting the Nazis as a gamble he wanted to win? In his words, at the end of the war, I am a member of the Nazi party. I am a munitions manufacturer. I am a profiteer of slave labor. I am a criminal. Yet he and his wife's act saved 1,200 Jews. The Czechs do not fully accept Schindler as he opens up cleaves in Czech history. But Schindler was Czech speaking and German speaking. He grew up in Moravia with Jews as neighbors and under Thomas Masaryk. He was first shocked at the Nazis for their treatment of the Czechs during the invasion in 1939. And in the end, he came home to build his ark. He would not have responded in the same way if he were not in some parts Czech, with an individual stubborn entrepreneurial trait that believed against the odds that you can take on the system and win. There are different views on Schindler. The first is from the Schindler Jews, their transcript collected by the Shoah Foundation. The vast majority focus on the value of his acts, his courage, risk-taking, and concern for his Jews. His motives remain more of an enigma. Pefferberg recalls that he gambled his life and all his money to save us. When he asked Schindler why, Schindler replied, "There was no choice. If you saw a dog going to be crushed under a car, wouldn't you help him?" A small minority questioned his motives, but representing the majority of many thousands of interviews, Ludwig Felberman says, "I don't know what his motives were. I asked him, but I never got a clear answer. But I don't give a damn. What's important is if he saved lives." Jitka Gruntova, a Czech historian, is more skeptical of Oskar Schindler's motives. She notes he was seen as a war criminal in both Czechoslovakia and Poland, and highlights the brutality of the German guards in the Brunionek camp, the difficulty of getting food, the deaths, and teaches us to look critically at the facts and at Schindler's motives. The most elusive source is Schindler himself. Schindler speaks rarely and modestly, like in an interview in 1964. The persecution of Jews meant we could see horror emerging gradually in many ways. In 1939, they were forced to wear Jewish stars and people were herded and shut up into ghettos. Then in the years 1941 and 1942, there was plenty of public evidence of pure sadism, with people behaving like pigs. I felt the Jews were being destroyed. I had to help them. There was no choice. After the war, when asked by Schindler Jew, he said, "I was a Nazi and I believed that the Germans were doing wrong when they started killing innocent people. And it didn't mean anything to me that they were Jewish. To me, they were just human beings. I decided I'm going to work against them and I'm going to save as many as I can. I hated the brutality, the sadism, and the insanity of Nazism. I just couldn't stand by and see people destroyed. I did what I could, what I had to do, what my conscience told me I must do. That's all there is to it. Really nothing more." Schindler himself did want to tell his story. After the war, he developed a film script, and I have the outline. It is called To the Last Hour, and it is based in Brunionec, Moravia. The film was discussed by the United States Congress in the 1950s, but they came to the conclusion that they were not ready for a film about a good German. The film was never produced. So that's part of the challenge, is to tell these stories now. We have 50,000 hours of testimonies of the Schindler Jews. We have very different historical viewpoints. And it really is to bring them alive in the site, which I think is very important to heritage. It has a particular force where the events occurred. And last year we brought back people from the village and from Brno to see the film in the place where it occurred. And this year we are going to work with school children in the Czech Republic and Germany to see how these stories can be communicated to the next generation. So I just want to tell you a little bit more. That's an idea of the stories. This is Margaret Libet and Eliska Charnlett. And these are the two of the people who really, really held the flame of the family stories and told them to me and had their incredible stories of escape themselves. Incredible force of character, but also this difficulty of the borders being closed. And I explain in the book the Evian conference, which occurs just across the lake from where I am now in Geneva, where all the countries convene to talk about the Jewish problem. So the first day in very kind of UN speak, they talk about the tragedy of the Jews, the hundreds of thousands, and it is a difficult situation. Who are stateless and how we need to do something. And on the second day, and Hitler on the eve of the conference says, we're ready to put the Jews in luxury ships if need be. And so they talk about the problem. And then on the second day, everybody closes their frontiers. The Australians say they have land, but as we have no real racial problem, we are not desirous of importing one. Canada welcomed skilled agriculture workers and took only 10,000 refugees. Brazil would only take Jews with a certificate of conversion to Christianity. France said it had reached saturation points. Britain said it was fully populated and suffered unemployment. And the USA would not increase their numbers in response to the crisis. Of all the countries present, only the Dominican Republic agreed to take a significant number of 100,000 Jews. And yet these members of the family escaped, and it's really their stories that explain where I am today and explain the survival, but also I think have many, many lessons for us that are relevant today. And I would go into more of the stories, but that's the passport, just to show how difficult it was. That's the passport of my father. It's actually his sister, Friedel, on the right. And you can see my father's name is forged on the left, Thomas Lobia, named after Thomas without the H, Thomas Masaryk, born in 1932, on the passport of his sister, Friedel, born in 1922. So she would have been 10 years old when she gave birth to my father. And really it was in the last moments. Often it was just, we did a meeting here in Geneva actually on diplomats that helped people during the war, the righteous and the diplomat. Almost all of them, their basic characteristic was they broke the rules. And obviously someone has broken the rules to allow my father to escape to England. And it was one of the certainly greatest satisfactions of Friedel when I talked to her, collected that story. As a psychoanalyst, she was also concerned that my father, who was uprooted from his country, then had to come and stay with her as her son in a girls' boarding school in England for the first year that he was there. And many stories. This is my dear Uncle Ian talking to Tick. She escaped from France with her parents. She told me the stories at her mother's funeral, who lived 99 and three quarter years, outlived the 20th century, an incredible story of survival. She has these wonderful blue eyes when she tells me that story. And the little details that will save you in these situations. So she crossed the border with something called the passeurs, who were these women who would take people across the border in the French underground. And this passeur's died a couple of weeks later, so it's an incredibly dangerous job. And they get stopped by the Nazi soldiers in the car. She's given chocolate, so she won't speak. And her parents are in the boot of the car. Her mother is pregnant. And the Nazis look around the car, and then they look into her eyes, and she's got these wonderful blue eyes, and they say, you have the blue eyes of Jesus, you must be fine. And they let them across the border. And that's how they escape and escape to America, where her father, who was a physicist, worked with Einstein. And then there are the stories of those who don't escape. So for every escape story, this is of my grandmother's mother, who escaped with my father and her to the border of England. And then she said, I can't come with you. I need to go back to get my other sister back in Central Europe. And I can't imagine my grandmother. She never really told me these stories. She had to, having saved her family, she had to say goodbye to her mother, who went back. And then we just have two letters from her as she is taken to Auschwitz.
And we must remember that for those that did escape, there were 6 million who did not. My grandmother did not tell me these stories, except maybe if I had listened a little closer to the silences in her conversation when she paused and remembered without words. On her terrace in London, as the sun dappled on the lily pond in her garden, her eyes would wander off somewhere where, as a child, I could not follow. There were pauses in her conversation and depths in her looks of absence, a background to her engagement with music, art, and the present. They were the dark black of her mirror, which allowed her to reflect her life. When I arrived at her door at the end of the long drive, she would hug the stuffing out of me like a bear, smother me with kisses like gravy, hold me to connect and show she was not going to let me go this time. Yes, with silence and smothering hugs, maybe she did tell me these stories of absence. Yet I regret the stories that were not told. It was only after the 20th century had ended, after my grandmother had died, that I was given two letters. They had been translated from German into English, and they were to my grandmother from her mother and sister. They were written on the 15th and 19th of June, 1944, days before they were to be transported to Auschwitz. What remains of these two letters sent to my grandmother when the deportations begin? The voice is clear, cogent, seeing, like a jewel or life about to be shattered, and unforgiving. The first letter is from the 15th of June, 1944. All sorts of rumours are spreading in the ghetto, and it is possible, God forbid, that they will come true. For this reason, I want to write to you before we come to be deported, meaning death. Although I like life very much, I look calmly at the future. My thoughts surround you daily and hourly, my dear children and grandchildren. Apart from a few Christians whom one can count on one's fingers, they have behaved so atrociously and subjected the ghetto to such suffering. May they receive just retribution at the just hand of God. The final letter follows 4 days later on the 19th of June, 1944. We are due to be deported in a few days. We have had faithful collaborators. Their names should be remembered when the day of reckoning arrives, and I ask you to hand these names to those who will be called upon to judge them. I will die more peacefully in the knowledge that the guilty collaborators will receive their just dues. In order to give you an idea of how we live, the ghetto is separated by a high wooden fence. A policeman stands in front of it. One is only permitted to have one chair. Eggs, butter and cream are forbidden. Meat is 100 grams per person per week. We must all wear yellow stars. Whoever fails to do this is sent to a concentration camp without pity. That is the Christian culture of loving your neighbour, which they pride themselves on. One is loaded into cattle trucks housing 50 and more persons. May our torturers and murderers be cursed. My dearest children and grandchildren, how I would have liked to have seen you all. My last thoughts will be for you all. My great-grandmother and her sister were sent to Auschwitz, where they were murdered. And that is how the story of 6 million Jews ends, like that. Death and often uncertainty about exactly when and how it happened. But still, I'm left with this is Eliska's arc.
Eliska's one for me really tells me of survival. She was coming to a school actually in Geneva, one of the first international schools. The Jews, having left the ghetto, they wanted to become Czech, they wanted to become European, and increasingly were becoming an international. My son has actually just started in that school this year, and when the war started, she had to flee, and she fled and hid with the headmistress of that school. She hid in her cottage on the border of near Biarritz in Hendaye in France. And really one of the biggest problems was, first of all, escaping Nazism, and then secondly, finding a place to go. So one of the big challenges, everybody closed their frontiers. Europe really closed itself, and she was unable to leave. Right across the sea from England, she was unable to come across into England. And she tells an incredible story. She just had a small dog with her, and the dog would insist on going out onto the beach in the evening and biting the ankles of Nazi soldiers. Clearly put her at huge risk, and she never knew why that the dog was able to find those particular ankles. But she then had to flee. She had to pay someone to close her in a railway carriage, and she fled across France. They locked the railway carriage as German soldiers walked up and down. She then escaped on a boat. She managed to find a visa. There was a remarkable Brazilian diplomat who gave her a visa to go to Brazil, but it's a long story, and she was delayed going to Brazil. She had a story of love on the boat. There's a wonderful personal story how she grows up from being a girl into a woman, and then she arrives in Brazil after all these adventures. And really, when she arrives in Brazil, they say to her, "Your visa has expired. You need to go back." And it just, for me, one showed the story of survival, this incredible woman who really never looked back. In some ways, the story personally is of her growing up from a child into a woman during the war.
So very much when these people told me their stories, and many of them have passed on, my grandmother, I realized they were from a world, a lost world, this radically modern European world, probably expressed itself more than elsewhere in Czechoslovakia, the new Czechoslovakia, particularly in Brno and Moravia. They had left the ghettos, they had built these factories, some of the biggest in Europe. They'd expressed themselves culturally, a new form of Judaism and European identity at the same time as the concentration camps. And for me, it's symbolized by a series of beautiful houses in Brno. Probably the peak is the glass home, the Tugendhat home. And really, I recommend, if you want to understand the heritage, understand the people and their stories. The traditional photos in black and white just show the architecture, but it was built as not just the bones and the skin of the building, but also the way of life for a particular family. And Daniela Tugendhat and Ivo have done a huge amount to restore it, but also in their book explain the details of life in that house, which for me expresses so much more, and they really should be involved in its future direction. And just the reading which explains those stories of that lost world, from the ghetto to the glass houses. Here is a reading from that chapter. There is a memorable moment at sunset in the glass room in the Mies van der Rohe house that was a Lobian Tugendhat family home in Brno. The low sunlight penetrates deep into the heart of the house. Light touches the onyx cream wall, which you can see there, this relationship between the inside and the outside. The cream wall marble's red, absorbing the sunset, and almost seems to bleed. Somehow the architecture and modern architecture come together at that moment. The outside is inside. Less is more, and beauty is in these details. The space of the open living room flows free like a river, the opposite of the closed ghetto. The glass skin, marble and chrome bones form a living body. The transparent white room and its jewel-like space seem at last to feel, to live and to bleed. The room has seen the 20th century. It saw the German and Jewish partnership in its design, the optimism and transparency of its vision, fresh and like nothing before. It saw the meeting to support Jewish refugees in the 1930s, then the Gestapo headquarters during World War II. It saw communism behind the Iron Curtain as a rehabilitation center was established here after the war. It saw the Velvet Revolution and the new Czechoslovakia. Near the end of the century, it saw the split of Czechoslovakia as the Velvet Divorce was signed in its premises. The house was not meant to see all of that. It was built to bring in a new modern era of transparency, a melting of German and Jewish culture, where there were no barriers or walls, just light and space. You almost float through its main glass room like walking on the moon. The glass home is the opposite of the ghetto where the Lobias had lived less than 90 years before. It is a negation of the ghetto, and yet at that moment of sunset, instead of melting white light, the onyx seems to bleed. You should stand in the room at sunset if you want to contemplate the short century when the Jews left the ghetto, what it meant for them to be surrounded by light and space, the attraction of the modern and the fusion of German and Jewish cultures, which was the renaissance of the Jewish and modern world. And yet it was all too short, too fragile. The Germans sent them back to the ghetto and it ended with blood on the walls. Outside, there is a view of old Brno. The lawns roll down to the traditional Lobia villa of Alfred, which is now the Lobia Museum. There are further Lobia villas in the Hlinki district next to the International Exhibition Center with its Art Nouveau and modern houses, the expression of a new Czechoslovakia. Yet like the crest of a wave on the hill above Brno, the glass house is a high point of a unique Jewish and European culture, which rose above what had come before, and then like a wave came crashing down. So those are the two stories in the book, those of escape and the concentration camp of our factory, which saved Jews, and the early escape from the ghettos, the glass home, that world that they left behind. And that I became very aware of as I talked to my family. Follow the follow your name. So you also find an entry, a very personal entry into history. And for me, it tells us much about the history of Central Europe. And that challenge in these buildings, these two places in heritage, that they're not just bricks. It's about bringing back the people and also those stories so that they can speak and form a story, certainly for the family, but also for those unique places in the center of Europe. And I know the Friends have been working very closely on that site with a number of those houses, which I think will provide a very unique place that hopefully can link the family and their stories back into those places of heritage. And really the final part then talks about how we are our stories, not just in the Jewish sense, but we were invited invited back in 2017. Daniela and Ivo played a central role in that, and we thought maybe there would be 10, 15 of the Lobias, the Stiaz, the Tugendhats would come back, but 80, 90, 100 came back, some of them listening today from throughout the world, many who had not been back to Brno, not been back to these places, and they shared the stories, and Ivo and Daniela took us around the house. Ruth Children played klezmer music in its spaces. That was haunts me still, that very modern Jewish presence that came with the music. Floating out from those windows over the garden, and the house, and I can explain, in heritage was 10, 20 times more meaningful. You saw what a museum, modern leading museum, could look like when it is linked to the people and their stories in those unique places. And then that the final reading is we were invited back to the town hall just to share and talk about our stories on the Saturday evening. So this is the reading from there. On the Saturday evening, we went to the Brno Town Hall for an open roundtable discussion with the mayor and the ombudswoman of the Czech Republic on our families. The ombudswoman was a kind, empathetic woman and good at listening, like a judge who listened to all sides but could not pass judgment. We expected a handful of local people would come to listen to the stories. To my surprise, the room kept filling up, row after row, until it was packed with 400 people, some now standing at the back. I realised that many of the people had not come for us or the lobbyists, but to hear firsthand their own history, to try to reconcile, untangle their own journey from the 1930s to the present. They were trying to find a path from the emergence of Czechoslovakia and through its prosperity in the 1930s, the Nazi invasion, the extermination of the Jews, the expulsion of the Germans, communism, the Velvet Revolution, coupon privatization, the dissolution of the Czechoslovak Republic, and joining Europe into the future. I stand by the stream in the new year on the spot where my grandfather has held up the Nazis 80 years ago. I can see and hear in the bubbling current of this stream that history is not just behind us. The arc of my family history has allowed me to feel the current of the past and of history, and now flows past me and ahead more freely to the future. And that's the final conclusion I would like to say is your family history, when you follow the story of your name, it's not just the past behind you, it's like this stream which flows through you. It's connected me to these places. Without that, there's no way I would have got involved in taking back our factory, these ruined buildings. And it flows to the future. And this is just a glimpse I want to leave you with of the new buildings that we are planning in the factory. Together with doing some textiles, working closely with the local village, also for some housing that they need. It has to be very much in line, as our partnership has always been, with the Czech village. That was the strength of that family factory and the three brothers. And we shared with them the plan last September, the consultation in Brunionets, and we're doing the first stages of that. That will be the future book, which will be about the arcs, not of escape, but of return. But it's still being formed yet. And I'm delighted that we're also working, and hopefully with a working party from the Friends of Czech Heritage, to see how heritage can really express not just our family, but the story of that very unique place, which is really in the center of Europe and is also central to the future of Europe. So I just want to show you finally the video of this story flowing into the future.